Welcome to RC Video Magazine, Volume 14. Let's get right to the flying action. First, we go to Higginsville, Missouri for the second annual Ace Float Fly.
I'm Tom Runge. Welcome to the second annual Float Fly here in Higginsville, Missouri, sponsored by Ace RC. A couple of years ago when we were test flying the Seamaster, one of our latest kits, we were out at our city lake here and realized that it's just the perfect site to hold a float fly. So we put a few things together and said, well, let's give it a whirl, sent out some flyers, and last year we had over 150 pilots show up. Here we are at the second year, and it's even larger, so we're real pleased with it. We've spent quite a bit of time getting ready and coordinating the event, and think we have a well-organized event.
As you might expect, Ace was the most popular brand of flying machine on the flight line at the Ace Float Fly. But there were plenty of other float planes of every description on the shore, in the air, and in the water. Puddle hoppers are fun to videotape. Their pilots are sometimes called muck jumpers, and they are a very social group.
You know what I mean, Vern?
Bad weather was constantly forecast, but no one minded when the day turned out quite nice. It was rare not to see several planes airborne. You don't have to be a hot dog to fly this event. This is an event to which you can bring the whole family. You can relax and enjoy a great weekend of float flying.
Okay, my name is Al Tuttle, and I'm from Port Orange, Florida. This airplane is a prototype of the Ace 120. It's a larger version of the little 40-size Seamaster. So it's going to be the Seamaster 120. It weighs 15 and 3/4 pounds, He's powered with the Super Tiger 3000. 18.8 prop, covered with monocoque. The airplane's covered with monocoque, not the prop. And these little deals on the side, these are the passengers. Stu Richmond down there in Apopka decided we better spice this thing up a little, and this is supposedly me, Captain Al, and this gal back here. She's one of our nice-looking ladies. The third one back with her hair sticking up is a kid on his first airplane ride. He's scared to death. And the fellow sitting backwards is a conductor. He's taking tickets as they come through the door.
171.
Okay, this is Jay Whitney from Lake Ozark, Missouri, and we're looking at a SIG quarter scale J3 Piper Cub with the clip wing, 7-foot wingspan. It's powered with an OS-160 twin and has an Eastcraft starter unit. This is the first, yesterday was the first flight off the floats, which was a winter project, and the plane handles absolutely fantastic. Of course, the crowd's real interested in the starter system. When you kill the engine and start it again, everybody gives you a clap. It's, the plane's approximately 3 years old and has lots of flights on it.
I'm from Topeka, Kansas. My name is Bill Dickey. The airplane was kind of a bet in our club to try to make something for this event. So I had this old-timer wing here. It's off of a Bowden, 1937 Bowden. It's Carol Crump designed. So we just stuck together a fuselage, and the idea was to start making two fuselages that were kind of like a Pete and Paul. And of course, you had to modify it a little bit to get it to leave the water. But that was the idea, just something to throw together and we could make it real quick and get over here for this event. And if they'd call me, I'd fly the thing, but I haven't been called yet.
How was that flight?
Didn't get it away, it died.
Yeah. Do you realize how many people just saw that?
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
I'm Paul Gribish from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I'm here with my wife, Deb. Okay, it's monocoque. Clip-wing version. They made several versions of the monocoque originally. The original ones had a longer wing, and then the owners started to clip them and make them more aerobatic and turn them into racing airplanes in the 30s. And this is semi-clipped. It could be clipped a little more. You could actually, for scale, you could actually take another half a foot off each side, but I'm not sure how it would fly. I've got wheels at home for it, and it works really good. It's a good flying airplane. It weighs 12 pounds without the floats. has a 90, OS Max 90 two-cycle in there, and has plenty of power. Power-to-weight ratio is very good on the airplane. Has a flat-bottom wing, but it does fly inverted very well, even with the floats on.
Hello, my name is Ronald Reagan, believe it or not, and I'm from Lake of the Ozarks, Missouri. And I've been into RC for about 13 years now, and this happens to be a SIG J3 Cub. I've got a Zenoa G23 in it. Those are Balsa USA floats, and they're made out of foam. And it seems to fly pretty good. It could use a little more power, but it flies real good. I did some modifications to make it into the Super Cub, as you can see, and I like it very well.
Flight line E, flight line E, transmitter 108B.
A unique method of retrieving dead aircraft was used. Specially designed RC boats were employed to bring the dead planes back to shore. Many pilots thought it looked like so much fun, they lined up to be the next to be rescued. It's not as easy as it looks. Ken Willard is the designer of the AC Master. It's just one of the many aircraft he has designed. His face is familiar to thousands of modelers who have read his magazine articles and heard of his world records.
I came here to the float fly to help promote the Seamaster, and while I was here, if you'll take a look at the man on my right, he came up and reminded me who he is. His name is Dick Carey. 30 years ago, in 1959, I set the world's endurance record of 5 hours and 29 minutes and 30 seconds. That record held for 5 years. We were using a simple little super regen, very wide band receiver, but the transmitter and the receiver was made by Orbit, but specifically it was put together by my friend Dick Carey, right here. And I haven't seen him since that time, and he comes up to me here in Higginsville and brings me some pictures of where he lives. And this is the man who made the reliable equipment to set the world's endurance record in 1959. And I'm sure glad to have him with me.
Mr. Carey, what have you been doing all these years?
Well, I traveled. I worked for NASA for a while on the Apollo program. Then I went to work for Emerson Electric and traveled worldwide setting up huge power plants and so forth all over the world for Emerson, and then 6 years ago retired. So I live on an island in the Mississippi right now. Well, Orbit started as a kitchen table operation back in those days. Bob and his wife both were employees of North American Aviation, and so was I. And he and his wife were building a 6-channel and an 8-channel receiver and transmitter. He had started with the single channel, and I was building the single channel transmitters and receivers at home on my kitchen table. Then we'd get together every weekend out at Miles Square and check them out, and there'd usually be about 10 guys for every one you had to sell. So we'd never take one home. We just took them out and checked them out, and that's where they disappeared. Then
it sounds like a marketing plan.
Oh, you didn't have to worry about marketing. The problem was supply. But he would take out two or three of the 6 channels or 8 channels, and I'd take out a dozen single channels, and we never brought one back. And this was once a week. Then finally we decided, well, we're either in business or we aren't. So we rented a 6,000-foot area building out in Garden Grove, California, and moved the entire business out there and hired 15 girls for assemblers and really started putting them out. So that's where Orbit was born, 11612 Annabelle. And that's where Ken and I first met, was on Annabelle Street there in Garden Grove when he came to pick up a transmitter and a receiver for Big Breathless.
That Orbit transmitter and receiver, along with the airplane, is now in the AMA Museum on loan from the Smithsonian Institution, where it was originally exhibited. And then Hearst Bowers of the AMA conned them out of it for the AMA Museum. But Smithsonian still owns it. It's on what they call permanent loan.
Floatplane owners weren't the only ones at the Ace Float Fly. A number of helicopter pilots strapped floats to their rotary wing machines and showed up at the Higginsville City Lake. Just like the fixed wing planes, the helicopters took an occasional dunking. Over 600 flights were flown in 2 days at the Higginsville City Lake. 150 pilots enjoyed the second annual Ace RC Float Fly. If you're interested in attending the Ace Float Fly next year, the dates will be June 2nd and 3rd, 1990. You can write Ace at Higginsville, Missouri, 64037. They'll send you the details. If you like to fly fast and turning left is more fun than turning right, consider organizing a Quickie 500 race. We're at Sullivan Field in Arvada, Colorado for the Arvada Associated Modelers 4th Annual Quickie 500 Pylon Race.
There are basically three major events that the AMA recognizes in which racing is active nationwide. Formula One is one of them. It's the biggest, fastest, and most expensive. There's also Quickie 500, which we're racing today, which involves very light, boxy airplanes. And then there's Quarter Midget, which is somewhere between the two. It involves airplanes that look like Formula Ones, are a little smaller, and they use 15 engines instead of 40-size engines, such as this one and the Quickies do.
Quickie 500 planes offer an inexpensive alternative to the big bucks high-flying Formula One and quarter-scale midgets, and still delivers all the grins and spins. The Quickie 500 series was designed in the mid-70s by a West Coast aero modeler named Glenn Spickler. He designed the series as an entry-level form of radio-controlled pylon racing for people who wanted to get into the sport without getting too deep into their wallets. The pilots are racing in 3- and 4-plane heats. The smaller heats make for less chances of air-to-air contact, although the competition can still get pretty close. While the pilot does the racing, his caller joins him in the dance of the Quickie 500. The course these planes are racing on is a long rectangle with turn one at one end and the other two turns at the opposite end. A minimum of 11 people are necessary to officiate an event like this. 4 flaggers in turn one pylon cage, 4 timers, 2 pylon judges for turns 2 and 3, and a race starter. Even though pylon racing has different classes, the equipment needed to stage an event is essentially the same. Booths or cages offer protection for course personnel and ensure a safe event. Louver signals or lights may be used. Much of the equipment can be scratch-built or may be available on loan from other race organizations. The equipment used here today is on loan from the Colorado Competition Society. If you're interested in this low-bucks, high-fun form of racing, get in touch with your local aero modeling club or competition organization and have yourself a Quickie 500. Top Gun. The term has come to represent perfection, the highest level of achievement. The first annual Top Gun tournament in Palm Springs, Florida has certainly attracted this level of scale builder and pilot.
Hi, I'm Frank Tiano. We're in Coral Springs, Florida. It's April 1989 at the Top Gun Invitational. You have my personal invitation to sit back and relax and watch some of the hottest flying you're ever going to see. We got 40 of the top scale pilots in North America competing for $20,000 in cash and merchandise. You are never going to see a show like this again. Watch it.
RC Video Magazine has come to balmy Coral Springs, Florida for the first annual Top Gun tournament. All of the nation's best scale builders and flyers are here by invitation. This will be the most unique scale competition ever. Cash prizes are being offered to the top five competitors. The top gun will take home $2,500 in cash, along with $2,000 in merchandise. Even the fifth place competitor will take home $500. Frank Tiano is the organizer of this Top Gun tournament. He was frustrated with the level of competition he found, and so he created his own event. The Top Gun tournament will be a tougher contest for the true competitor. A rule book will be used for the first year only, then the contestants will vote on changes in the rules. You're watching Bob Heitkamp's Junkers JU-87G Stuka. It's scratch-built with operating flaps, landing lights, nav lights, and firing cannon. Bob's plane is powered by a Super Tiger 2500 and controlled with the Airtronic Spectrum 7 radio. Bob's a retired Air Force pilot. When he's not controlling RC models, he controls the real thing as an air traffic controller in Juneau, Alaska. The B-17 was nicknamed the Flying Fortress. This is Tom Street's Top Gun entry. It weighs 40 pounds and has a 10-foot wingspan. Power is provided by four OS-61 four-stroke engines. Tom uses a Futaba 1024 radio system. The B-17 has flaps, bomb drop, smoke, and retracts. Tom is a pilot for Southwest Airlines, flying Boeing 737s. Tom reports he's taken off 255 times with the B-17, but admits to only 253 landings. Sponsoring the Top Gun was the Condors Club. They worked hard by enlisting the help of the city of Coral Springs and the local JCs. Jointly, they brought in bleachers, large tents, food concessions, and traffic control. The JCs charged $3 at the gate as a fundraiser. The money was given to the city of Coral Springs to build a children's park. The event raised a lot of money and created a lot of goodwill. And that helped to make this a first-class competition. This World War I Newport was built by Bob Henth. Bob has been building models for 50 years. He's a former Navy pilot. The Newport has the color and markings of the 94th Hat in the Ring Aero Squadron. It's powered by an OS Gemini 4 stroke twin and controlled with an Airtronic Spectra 7 radio. Shailesh Patel brought along this F6-F3 Hellcat as his Top Gun entry. Built to 1/5 scale, its wingspan is 80 inches. It features retracts, flaps, bomb drop, tank drop, sliding canopy, and has a Webra bully pulling it. Shailesh is from Eureka, California. This Aranca sedan was scratch-built by Steven Sauger. Check out the rich detail. Steve designs new cars as an engineer for Chrysler. He's a flight instructor at his local airport in Michigan. The Aranca weighs 14 and a half pounds, and it's powered by an OS-90 four-stroke engine. Many of these aircraft are highly complex in their mechanical features. It's up to the pilot to make sure the judges know what optional functions they will use during their flights. Charlie Chambers showed the judges the many features of his P-51. Charlie's Mustang is entirely covered with metal sheeting, which makes it appear very realistic. He used printer plates and tooled in the rivets. This Mustang weighs 22 and a half pounds, and it's powered by a Moki 2500. Let's watch the spectacular takeoff of Charlie Chambers. He gently reminds those along the flight line to stay on their toes. Here's a more normal liftoff of the P-51. Regrettably, Charlie's P-51 met its end on a takeoff attempt during the final round of competition. Charlie is a top modeler and a top competitor, and we know we'll see him again at the Top Gun tournament. Charlie's airplane was not the only one lost during the competition. Colonel Art Johnson's outstanding B-26 Marauder lost power on takeoff and didn't clear the fence.
Uh-oh.
Mike Kolzik's F-105 went in after losing power. On Sunday morning, Jeff Troy's classic Bolero crashed for unknown reasons.
Can you tell us about your vertical landing aircraft?
Yeah, this is a Grumman Avenger. You can see the fold-back wings. It took a little while to get the carrier stance right, but it didn't take too long. About 3 seconds worth, actually.
Seriously, what happened?
No, seriously, I don't know what happened. We had a problem with the rudder yesterday, but the rudder's still attached to the tail post today, so it wasn't the same thing, though the reaction was the same. I flew out and over, and it just spiraled up, tightened up, and went in. And it looks like something let go today. The radio seems to be fine. I sure would not blame the radio system.
It didn't spiral in. How you feeling?
No, this went straight. How do I feel?
I got on tape.
Wonderful. How are you?
There were a number of close calls. Ted White broke a prop blade on takeoff, but he was able to get his P-47 back on the runway with a one-blade prop.
Beautiful save, beautiful save. Actually threw on one-blade prop.
Don Parsons does some fast flying with a twin-engine Hornet. When an engine flames out, he simply brings it in and sets it down on the white line. Mel Sandmeyers adds a few scratches to his beautiful beach stagger wing. Charles Nelson took seventh place with this VKS-7F Waco Cabot. Power is provided by an OS-91 four-stroke engine. It has flaps, retractable landing gear, and lights. In sixth place was this Curtis JN4D Jenny. It's flown by Dick Hansen. This is the prototype of the Proctor kit. Power comes from an Enya 80 four-stroke. Fifth place went to Chuck Fuller and his scratch-built Ryan PT-22. This 24-pound airplane has smoke and flaps. It's powered by a Zenoa engine. Cliff Tacy captured fourth place with a Savoia Marchetti SM-81. Power comes from three KNB-35 engines. This plane has flaps, bomb drop, and weighs 14 pounds. This is a scratch-built project. This Lockheed Hercules C-130E was built from scratch by Skip Mast. He and his plane placed third. Power comes from four K&B engines that lift the Hercules, which weighs 14 pounds. The plane has flaps, retracts, and cargo drop. Its wingspan is 97 inches. Neil Snodgrass flew to a second-place finish with his Piper Midwing Special. A systems programmer from Churchville, Maryland, Neil built this quarter-scale model that weighs in at 22 pounds. It's powered by a Tartan twin. And here's the top gun. Bob Fiorenzi flew this F-18 Hornet to first place. It's a twin-engine ducted fan jet, a prototype of the new yellow aircraft kit. Powered by two OS-77 engines with Dynamax fans, this jet spans 72 inches and weighs 27 pounds. It's a 1/7 scale with fiberglass wings and fuselage. The handmade retracts are entirely scale, including the pneumatic disc brakes.
Here it is. I wasn't lying. You want to see more? You come to Coral Springs, Florida in 1990. Last weekend in April, Coral Springs, Weston Hotel, RC Video, right here, 1990. It's even going to be better. Maybe 50 pilots, maybe 10 entries in team scale. It's going to be hot.
Let's go to Terry Edwards' hobby shop. He's ready to show us products that make RC modeling a lot more fun.
Welcome to my hobby shop. Thank you for coming in. In fact, I think you were my last customer. Well, let's get on with some business here. We have some products that we've tried and we'd like to go with. The first thing I'm going to show you, everybody knows what this is. It's a DigiPace. Now take good care of your batteries. This DigiPace is set up so it'll discharge and tell you how long your battery is good for. And this one's been on about 16 minutes now. It's still holding well. I just wanted to remind everybody that that is really a handy product. I just started using it here recently and I'm real happy with it. The next thing we have is an item everybody's familiar with, the NiStarter. They come with a charger. What I wanted to show you about this one is it's the new model. It has a stainless steel end on it so that it doesn't get all chewed out and it'll hold on your glow plugs. This particular one also has a voltmeter in it, so that you can tell how much time you have left to run your glow plugs. Everybody knows about NiStarters, but just want to remind you that they're really a good product. Robart has come out with a new and improved jig for drilling holes for hinges. I'll see if I can figure out how to make this thing work. I had it figured out once. This jig really does work well. It centers. You can drill right on through there. It doesn't take anything to keep your drill straight so that it works good. You grab your hinge, poke it in, and you're set. It's in the center, and it really works great. This is a product that we've been using here for a while, and we're really happy with it. Next thing we have are these sanding blocks by Bell Mountain Industries, BMI. I always have an awful time keeping my edges straight and smooth when I'm trying to grind them down and make them round. This thing does a great job. It's so easy that even I can use it. I know a lot of you have seen this, but it does really work. And there you have it. Smooth, even edges all the way around. Now, how can you go wrong with a thing like that? With a klutz like me, I have an awful time getting rounded edges. This next item are SIG's new super hinges. Now, I'm sure a lot of you have seen these, but I'm going to go through it anyhow because I want to make sure everybody knows about this. These hinges, all you have to do is slot the wood. These flexible hinges go in. You can cut them to any size you want. You put that hummer together. It goes together easily. Take a little thin glue, put a drop on each side. Let them set for a minute, and they're ready. Here's one that we put together a few minutes ago. Should be dry now. Let's see how strong that is. I shouldn't be able to pull that apart, because, boy, they are really tough. Let me twist it and see what I can do. There it is. Boy, I pulled that wood right out of there. The hinges still have wood glued all over them. That's going to work. That is really a good product. Now, tools are one of my favorite things. I found something the other day that I think is just greater than sliced bread. This is a little drill that came from Radio Shack. It's basically a pin vise that you can twist. Where I found this good is for mounting servos on servo rails. I could just go in, put a little pilot hole for the wood screws, and we're in business. And this thing works so slick, it's easy to hang on to. It drills right through in a short time and does a great job for you. We were talking about the safety glasses a little while ago. Now, this is a class act. You've seen the ads for Safety Plus. Well, they say you can shoot them and they'll take it. We've got a tape where we took it out and tested it. I'd like to show that to you. You want to roll the tape? Well, you saw those shots. Here's what's left. The pellets from that shotgun hit it hard, but none of them went through. Not a one of them. So my head would have been blown clear off, but boy, my eyes would have been in good shape. Here's the pair that we ran over with the tractor. You notice they didn't come apart. They're not broken. They're anything. They still work. They'd still protect your eyes. Of course, they're a little scratched up, kind of hard to see through, but they did save my eyes. So I hate it when a tractor runs over me and it takes out my eyes. So these are a good product. They do as advertised. They really do protect you. Well, this is Eldon Lin's Magna Board. I'm sure you've all read the ads and a lot of you have used it, but it's another product that's been on market for a while, but I just began to use it and I really like it. We put up a Sagitta 600 wing here last night, and I wanted to show you how well this works. The magnets hold everything in place. For the fuselage, we have these magnet pieces that hold it together. And let me give you a little more detail on this. We'll get rid of this wing here so that you can see the grid on the board. Everything's lined up in quarter-inch squares. Now, when you use it, you put the plans down with your wax paper, and these magnets go on there, and they are tough. Those things really hold in place. These, for fixing the fuselage size and for holding everything square and vertical, they're adjustable. You can loosen the nut, tighten them up any angle you need so that they work good, and they just come back on there and hold that fuselage in good shape. So these really hold well. I was a surprise. No more pins for me. From now on, it's this thing, because those, you can place them easy. You can slide them on the board, but they really do hold. Hey, you turkey, what the? Oh. I really hate it when I have to do that, but at least we'll eat well tonight. Okay, well, I hope we don't have to do that again. It's hard enough to get paying customers in this place. I hate to have to shoot them all the time. Well, we have a system here that I think is fascinating. This is Pelican's fiber optic aileron driver system that has long fiber optic tubes that drive these aileron servos so that you don't have the aileron wires going through the wings to give you interference. Let me show you how this works. I've got it jury-rigged here so we can make it go. You see, with a slight touch of my hand, I'm driving the two servos. Now, the amazing part of this is that these servos aren't electrically connected to the receiver. They're done through this fiber optic. Now, you see, I'll disconnect this one optic fiber, and the one servo, we lose it. So it's not working. This is really a slick looking outfit. I think we're going to enjoy playing with that. Well, that's enough of that. I have another goodie that you're going to like. SR found this toolkit that they're marketing, and it is really slick. It's absolutely essential that every time you go to the field, this is in your field kit. It'll do anything you want to do. Look at the goodies. It has an extension handle. It has Phillips, Allen screws, flat screw screwdriver, anything you want to do. If you need the ratchet, you have it. You can make that little Hummer go, screw those screws in, and you're in good shape. I don't know why I didn't see this before, but but that is really slick. I think that's the greatest thing we've had here yet today. I'll just add that to the pile over here. As I have one more item that came in that I'm really enthusiastic about. Sonictronics is getting into the electrics business. They've come out with a bunch of propellers and a new adjustable electric motor mount. Now the thing about these propellers is in the small sizes, they have hubs that are interchangeable for different size prop shafts. So you don't have to ream that rascal out and then it doesn't fit on some of your other motors. Now, the motor mount. These are two little plastic mounts that slide over the motor. They have a tube for alignment, two tie wraps, put it together, screw it to the firewall, and you're done. Now you know how much trouble it is to get these darn electric motors mounted. They are also coming out with some new larger propellers. I have one mounted on my motor here. This is the 12-inch one. These really look slick. They're going to do these in 11 to 15-inch sizes. So I think that they've come out with a real nice product here. I haven't had a chance to use it, but you know how good an electric flyer I am. So I'm going to take this and put it on my airplane that the last time you remember I had a little trouble with it, so I need a new prop. So this is going on that airplane, and I'm going to go fly. Thank you for coming in. See you next time.
While at Miles Square Park in Southern California, RC Video Magazine had an opportunity to tape the first test hop of a 1/2-scale Corbin Super Ace, built by Jack Dennis of Riverside, California. Jack Dennis wanted a big plane. When he built his first radio-controlled airplane 20 years ago, he wanted a plane that would offer the same flying experiences he had as a professional pilot. Dennis chose the quarter-scale J3 Cub. After a 12-year absence from RC flying, Jack returned, and he came back looking for an even bigger challenge. Not only did he want something big, he wanted something unique, rare. As unique and rare as his quarter-scale plane from 20 years past. So here's Jack's half-scale Corbin Super Ace. It's patterned after the 1930s Corbin-designed plane that was powered by a Ford Model A engine. Jack built this stunning Corbin half-scale Super Ace using pictures and drawings from a 1935 issue of Aviation Magazine.
Why?
The wingspan is huge, measuring 13.5 feet. Power is provided by a 4.2 Sachs-Dulmer engine with ignition. The airframe is half-inch spruce and balsa. The landing gear is 4130 chromoly, just like the original plane. Shock absorbers are fully functional. This is its first flight test. Notice the 12-inch scooter wheels. Test pilot Gene White is the first to fly the Super Ace. After a brief liftoff, he enthusiastically recommends some trim adjustments. After a few minor changes and some different wheels, Jack and Gene White returned the following day for an absolutely wonderful flight. We have a different kind of article for you in this edition of RC Video Magazine. Let's explore the 1989 World Helicopter Association USA team trials. We've made a photographic scrapbook with some 35mm slides from Ed Nakasone and some home video shot by Al Schneider for RC Video Magazine. This year's USA team is made up of veterans. There's the defending champion, Curtis Youngblood. He's joined by Tom Dooley, Tim Skinnard, Robert Gorham, and alternate Ted Skinnard. The team is managed by Cliff Hyatt. Later this year, RC Video Magazine will have a major article on the USA team and its members. That will come after the World Helicopter Championships.